happy service. Amen. Praise God. God bless you. Are you ready for the word? It's Pentecost Sunday. Amen. Stand to your feet if you would. Acts chapter 2. What else is there to talk about other than the feast and the celebration of Pentecost? It is not just another day for Pentecostals. Amen. It was a day that would set the pattern for the New Testament church. It is a day that many people long for. Hebrews says that they long to see this day, but they couldn't get it, those in the Old Testament. But now, here it is. Jesus has made his promise. He said, I'm going to send another comforter to you. I'm not going to leave you comfortless. He said, I'm going to send the promise, amen. I'm going to send the paracletos, amen, the one who's going to come alongside of you. And here it is, the day, amen. And so today we join with thousands of other churches around the world celebrating the promise of the Father. Amen. The release of the Holy Ghost would be poured out unto the believers. And so what you won't see on TV is that there's a great move of God taking place all over the world. What they will show you are the craziness that's going on in London. Amen. But if they would just turn their attention over toward Israel and toward Jerusalem, they will show you, praise God, that there is a celebration that is going on, because that is where what they celebrate is what we learn. What they're celebrating is that this is the day. This day is where God would come and bring the commandments and say, this is how I want you to live.
Yeah.
They're celebrating that. But what we are celebrating, praise God, and it lines up on the exact same day. That is amazing to me.
Yeah.
It is the exact same day, amen, that we celebrate the day in which the Holy God was going to pour out his Spirit upon all flesh.
Yes.
Amen. Hallelujah. And it's like God is trying to tell us that while there's a lot of craziness that's going on out in the world, he is not going to sit back idly and allow nothing to take place. He will pour out his Spirit upon all flesh. Amen. And I believe that the fire of decay will not match the fire of the Holy Ghost that can be presented in his place. Amen. Hallelujah. So in the book of Acts, I'm going to begin over in Acts chapter 2. And it says that on the day of Pentecost, in verse 1, when it was fully come, somebody say fully come.
Fully come.
Hallelujah. There they all were in one accord and in one place. And then suddenly, somebody say suddenly.
Suddenly.
Suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. And it filled the house where they were all sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues, and like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. Hallelujah. And they were all, come on, say it with me, they were all filled
with the Holy Ghost.
And they began speaking with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Hallelujah. This would be a moment in history, praise God, that God was not going to be denied. And I believe that his children are not to be denied also. This would be the fulfillment of the promise. They waited for this. They tarried in Jerusalem all of these days, 120 of them in that small room. And we've been there. When we went to Jerusalem, it's no bigger, it's smaller than this room, but there were 120 of them. And for 50 days, they prayed, they waited with an earnest expectation they had. What are we waiting for? We're waiting for the promise. And it happened. Suddenly, the Holy Spirit came and filled that place.
Yeah.
And everybody that was in there began to lift up. It was like flaming tongues of fire hit on everybody that was in that room.
Yeah.
And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. And even though they were all from different nations, different nationalities, different creeds, different ethnos, it didn't matter, because the Holy Spirit breaks all the barriers. Hallelujah. And it doesn't matter what denomination you come from. It doesn't matter what your socioeconomic class is. It doesn't matter the color of your skin. Are y'all hearing me today? What matters is, praise God, does the Spirit of God dwell in that place? And if the Spirit of God dwells in that place, then we can all celebrate and relate to the same Father. Hallelujah. All right, God, but you may have your seats. Amen. Jesus promised it. We celebrated, praise God. Our Judeo-Christian values go back to the day of Pentecost, where 120 believers from different nationalities, cultures, languages, all experienced the prophetic. They experienced the profound. They experienced the promise, the presence, the provisions, and the power of our Lord. Yes. This day is the day that the church, the New Testament church, was born. Happy birthday, New Testament church. Now, the sad part about that is that most Christians, that if you ask them, when was the church born, the New Testament church born, they won't be able to tell you. But you will hear in my speaking today that we celebrate, when was the church born? Today. The church was born today on the day of Pentecost. Hallelujah. How do we know that, Pastor? Because Jesus promised. He said, when I leave, I'm not going to leave you comfortless. I'm going to send another comforter, amen, and he will teach you and guide you and lead you. Not only my God, because there's no way you could keep the commandments that were written on stone. But what you can do is you can keep the commandments written in your heart. Yes. So I'm not writing commandments on tablets of stone anymore. I'm writing tablets on the hearts of men. Yes. So that way when the Holy Spirit comes, amen, not only will he walk with you, but he'll dwell in you.
Yes.
What I want to share with you is that not only will he dwell in you, but he'll flow out of you.
Yes.
And touch other people's lives. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And so there they were. Amen. Jesus promised it over in, you got to keep up with me, Sierra, over in Luke chapter 24 and verse 49. He said, behold, he said, I'm going to send the promise, amen? I'm going to send the promise of my Father to you. You wait in the city of Jerusalem until you be endowed with power from on high. Jesus, endow me, Lord, with power from on high, amen?
Amen.
In John chapter 14 and in verse 16, he says, I will ask of the Father, and he will send you another.
Yes.
One said it was going to be an advocate. Mm-hmm. One said it was going to be a comforter.
Yes.
Where my sonship students at?
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
He said he's going to send the paracletos,
yes,
the one that's going to come alongside of you. What are you saying, Pastor?
Glory.
Praise God. Regina, can I borrow you for a second?
Glory.
Praise God. And there you are. Praise God. You're walking by yourself. You minding your business. But then you don't know how you're going to get through all of your journeys. But God says, watch this, he says, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit will come alongside of you and walk with you everywhere you go. So he'll lead you. God, talk to you about what life is all about. Speak to you. Convict you when you're wrong. Teach you how to do the right way. But nevertheless, I'm going to be with you. I'm never going to leave you comfortless. So even in your most difficult times, the Holy Spirit, can I get a witness with that? Even in your most difficult times, even in most times when you are unsure, the Holy Spirit will come alongside of you and link up with you and remind you, you are not comfortless. Let's walk this journey together. And the more you walk the journey, you realize the presence of the Holy Spirit. Watch this. As you go your way, if the presence of the Lord is not with you, you'll know the difference. Can I get a witness? And so God wants to let us know that the presence of the Holy Spirit is the missing link in many churches today. Hallelujah. He said, but I'm going to ask the Father. He's going to send another comforter, amen, that will be with you, amen, that you will be and abide with you forever, amen. It is the Spirit of truth. And then it says that the world, watch this, the world cannot receive him because it doesn't see him.
That's right.
Neither does it know him.
That's right.
That's right.
But you,
hallelujah,
you know him.
Yes.
And you know that he's going to dwell with you, and he's not only going to dwell with you, but he shall be
in
you.
Now that makes the difference.
Yes.
I've had friends that said, man, every time I come to one of your services or every time y'all have, I just sense the Spirit of God. Unsaved folks, I sense the presence of the Lord when I walked in the room.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Well, how is that? You're not saved, but something about your church, something about the people, something about that sanctuary, it reminds me that the Spirit of the Lord is in that place.
Yeah.
I remember one time we were thinking of selling the building, this goes back a ways, and a man walked into the room, and he says, Mike, none of y'all were here, and he walked into the room, and he says, my God, The Spirit of the Lord is in this room.
Hallelujah.
I'm looking around, there's nobody in the room but me and him. He said, "You guys have awesome church services here, don't you?" I said, "Yeah, we do. We have a lot of fun." He said, "So why do you want to sell the building?"
My God.
If the Spirit of the Lord is here, don't get rid of it.
Yes.
Keep what you have.
Yes.
So here we are.
Amen.
The promise. He sends the promise. The promise, by definition, according to dictionary.com,
yes,
says that a promise, hallelujah, I don't know who this is for, a promise is a statement telling someone that you will definitely do something or something will definitely happen in the future. The word of emphasis is the word definitely. It is going to happen.
Yeah.
How many of you know if God said it, that settles it?
Yeah.
All right. Yes, sir.
It's an indication, a promise is an indication of future success or improvement. And then lastly, my favorite, yeah, is number three, is that it is a reason to expect that something will happen in the future.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord, for getting to expect something in the future. When God wants to bless His children, He's not just blessing you for right now. He's blessing you for where you are going to go in the future. And I don't know how many of you are in here today, but you have an expectation of something that God has promised you, and He is going to perform it. Amen? So I don't know about you, but I'm thankful. Praise God. I'm so thankful that He gave me a promise.
Yes.
I'll never leave you nor forsake you. So I'm going to hold on to that promise, and I'm going to walk in that promise.
Yes.
Hallelujah. If He promised me that I would be prosperous, then I'm going to walk in the promise that He is going to make me prosperous.
Yes.
If He said I'm going to heal you, and I promise I'm going to heal you, I'm going to walk in that healing. If He said I'm going to prosper you, you promise, Lord? Yes, I promise. Amen. Hebrews says when He could spread by no greater, He swore unto Himself, saying, "Surely with blessings I'm going to bless you, and with multiplies I'm going to multiply you."
Yeah. Yeah.
When I told my granddaughter, praise God, Zoe, after we do this, Zoe, we are going to go over to the park. We're going to go get Icy's. We're going to go to Iggy's.
Come on.
Amen.
You promised, Pop Pop? Yes, I promised, baby girl. She looked at me and she said, "Pinky swear, Pop Pop."
Oh,
if you know, it got serious then.
Yeah.
Pinky swear, Pop Pop. Because if I said it,
yeah,
I got to honor it.
Yeah.
And I said, "Pinky swear, baby girl." And she had a big old grin on her face. For the rest of the day, hear me, she walked with the expectation that Pop Pop was going to fulfill his promise.
Yeah.
What kind of God would we serve? Amen. That if He promised and reneged on it, if He promised and changed His mind, if He promised and said, "Oh, I was just kidding." But somebody in here should be able to attest that when God promised something, my God, He promised it. He promised the Holy Ghost. He said, "I'm not going to renege on my promise. All you got to do is to stay diligent to what I said for you to do." You go to church, amen, for every day for a month and a half, 50 days. And I promise you it's going to happen. Can you imagine being in Jerusalem? Not just for the day of Pentecost, but for the feast of Pentecost. The Bible says that they came from all over. Jerusalem was filled. There was a multitude of people that were there. Amen. And people from every nation, every tribe and kindred were coming to celebrate this feast. Well, they came to celebrate. They came to celebrate that the Ten Commandments, and they would do reenactments of Moses coming down with the Ten Commandments. They would celebrate their feast. They would eat bread. They would drink wine. They would have the cedar meal. They would do a lot of different things that would commemorate the Ten Commandments coming down and how God was going to perform the miraculous in their lives. They would rehearse the stories. Hear me, beloved.
Yes.
They would rehearse the stories.
Yes.
Do you not remember what I did to Pharaoh and his boys and how I drowned them in the sea? Do you not remember how I shut you up and never had you to go into slavery again? Do you remember how I called you to prosper and walk into your own land and land filled with milk and Y'all don't want to say amen. Amen. And you rehearse these songs, rehearse this over and over again to your children, again and again and again. It's like a family reunion. You rehearse it again. You tell your children a story. We weren't always, listen, we didn't always live like this.
Amen.
There was a time, praise God, when we lived in the projects and we had to eat peanut butter and jelly sandwiches and Kool-Aid with no sugar and mayonnaise sandwiches. Schools, amen, in order to get a good education. I remember the times, and if you know me, you know I don't mind sharing my story of how I got here because I am thankful for where I am now, but I will never forget how you got there.
Amen.
And so what they would do in their history, they would say, do you remember the story of Abraham? You remember the story of Isaac? You remember the story of Jacob? Do you remember the story of David and Joseph? Do you remember the story? Do you remember the story? Do you remember the story? And let's eat and let's break bread and let's drink wine. And those of you who weren't here with us last Wednesday, you missed it because they drink a lot of wine. And so you can imagine, I'm telling the truth. And they drink a lot of wine, they sing a lot of songs. Amen. And so we didn't drink a whole lot of wine there, amen. We just ate the cheesecake, but they did teach us a song.
Yeah.
All right.
I'm not gonna ask you. They did teach us how to blow the shofar.
Yeah.
To announce it's time for all of God's people to gather together.
Yeah.
And so between the shofar being blown and the wine and the stories, can you see that there was a party going on? And so for us, everybody was gathered in Jerusalem. Hallelujah. It's the Feast of Feasts, the Tabernacle. Hallelujah. But on the side over here were 120 people. I understand all that was going on over there, but why are you here? I'm waiting for the promise.
Come on.
What promise? The promise that Jesus told us that he would never leave us nor forsake us. Our master is gone. There's no more sermons. There's no more miracles. There's no more dealing with the Pharisees. There's no more beatitudes. There's no more land. There's no more dealing. Jesus is gone, and we don't know what to do with what we have.
Yes.
And just like the church today, we don't know what to do with what we have.
Yes.
So God says, I'm going to send you the very thing that you need.
Yes, Lord.
The Holy Ghost.
Yes, yes.
What? It's not knowledge.
Come on.
It's Holy Ghost.
Yes.
It's not songs. It's the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Turn to your neighbor and say, Holy Ghost.
Holy Ghost.
Now some people are so, it is so profound that some people don't even want to say Holy Ghost. They want to say Holy Spirit. Because it seems less intrusive. Because even the term ghost has such an illusion to it that we don't understand it. It's mysticism and we don't understand it. I get that. So I'll just say Holy Spirit to make y'all comfortable. But in my Pentecostal roots,
come on, Pastor.
Holy Ghost. And I don't mind sharing that only because the things that you don't understand, the Holy Spirit will bring back to your remembrance exactly what you need to say. When you don't know what to pray, when words get in the way, you pray according to the Holy Ghost, and the Holy Spirit will give you exactly what you need to say. And even if you don't know what to say, he says, I'll give you a language to speak it in.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. And so There they were. Let's go back to the text. I'm sorry. I mean to deviate. But the Bible said they were all together in chapter 2 and in verse 1 when the day of Pentecost was fully come. Those 120 people, they gathered together and they were on one accord. Somebody say one accord. They were on one accord. In other words, there was no doubt as to why their purpose was there. Amen. I got in trouble one time because a Catholic person, because I used to be Catholic a long time ago, and a Catholic person said, well, you know, the Holy Spirit died with the apostles. And I said, I understand. I said, but did you know that even Mother Mary was present on the day of Pentecost? What? Yet she was in the room. Are you hearing me? The Bible says in Acts chapter 1 and verse 14, it says, and all these continued with one accord in prayer and supplications with the women, and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brethren were all there. What? What? Is it possible that Mary, Jesus' mother, was still with the Holy Ghost around with them? Hallelujah. What that tells me is that being filled with the Holy Spirit is not a denominational issue. It's an ecclesiastical issue. It's a church issue. He tells us that regardless of what denomination you came, I have found my God. Spirit-filled Catholic churches, Spirit-filled Baptist churches, they call them Baptocostals. And we sing this cross because people are really recognizing that it's not the song. It's the spirit behind the song.
Yes.
It's not the preacher.
Right.
It's the spirit that is within the preacher.
Yes.
There is no power.
Come on.
Even when you say power, there ought to be something behind your preach. Power in the Holy Ghost makes a difference in every church, every service, and in every language, and we're from different parts of the world.
Yes.
We don't understand this.
Yes.
Maybe they are drunk because they like to drink. Maybe they are drunk. But then one of the apostles stood up and said, "Oh, ye men, these men are not drunk as ye suppose.
Yes.
But this." This is the promise that we've been waiting for. Say in one sentence what it would take you off.
mind.
Without the Holy Spirit, my God, there's no conviction.
Hallelujah.
I never got convicted by the Holy Spirit before.
Come on, yeah.
But I've been there. My God, I would be somewhere eating something, and the Holy Spirit.
Come on, Pastor.
I've been transparent. Right. Come on, Pastor. I had just preached no more chips.
No more chips.
I just preached. No more chips. No more soda. I just. Come on. I have to say, not being transparent.
Yeah.
But in my own rationalizations, I would go,
anybody
around?
All right.
God knows my heart. His grace is sufficient.
Yeah.
Suffering for today. And I repent, oh God. But right now, the Holy Spirit will come along and say, when you're weak. I'm strong. And I looked. Who said that? It wasn't somebody natural. It was the Holy Spirit that came along. You ever had one of those weird experiences? But like the Holy Spirit will. And you go, who is speaking that to me? And it's me. I'm here to comfort you, to strengthen you when you're weak. So that way you will not be comfortless. So go ahead, turn your head this way, and keep walking past those chips. We'll do this. With tears in your eyes. Say, oh, Pastor, that's not very spiritual. When you face your
amen.
You get into a place where there's nobody around you, and you have a great opportunity to sin.
Come on, right.
You're going to need the Holy Ghost to come alongside, because I can't come.
Yeah.
I can't be there. Pastor, would you come? I can't come right now.
Come on.
But what I can do is send the Spirit.
Yes.
Yes.
And the Spirit, in a flash of a light, will be there.
Yes.
So I'm here. Okay? Take my hand.
Yes.
I'm going to get you through the chips and the cookies.
Yay,
Lord. Neighbor, say, neighbor, we need the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Without the Holy Spirit, amen. Praise and worship are just songs. They're just songs, amen. Without the Holy Spirit, the preached word of God is just another talk. Right now, amen. Jesus said, my words, they are spirit and they are life. So even as I'm speaking, amen, I'm speaking spirit to you to let you know, amen, that we need the Holy Spirit. And I pray, my God, and I pray that we have a spirit-filled church, a spirit-filled believers. Getting saved is one thing, and I've already said this many times, getting saved is one thing, staying saved. It's a whole nother thing.
Yes.
And how many of you know that you need the power of the Holy Ghost to stay saved?
Yes.
Amen.
Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor,
amen.
Stay saved. Come on, find another neighbor. Look at him. Look at him in the right one. Find another neighbor. Tell him, call it in. Tell him, stay saved. Stay saved. And you need the power of the Holy Spirit in order for you to be able to do that. We need, my God, I'm going to ask you for the title. It's called Pentecost in Our Presence. We need Pentecost in our everyday lives. We need the Holy Ghost present in our lives. Amen. Why? Because it gives us an expectation. The song we used to sing, praise God, expect the great.
Yeah, that's right.
Hallelujah. Expect supernatural breakthrough.
Yes.
Expect healing. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Deliverance.
Amen.
Expect miracle signs and wonders.
Yes.
God wants us every time we come to church to have an expectation for something that we've never seen before, something that we've never done before. But he says, expect it, praise God, because I'm the God who promised.
Amen.
Pinky swear. When I could swear of no others, I swore by myself.
Yes.
Back in Brooklyn, they used to say, I swear to God, or I swear at my mother's grave.
Uh-huh.
I'm not going there. But what I will say, Lord, you swore.
Mm.
Can you imagine God saying, I'm going to lead you. I'm going to bless you. Who is that for?
Yeah.
I'm going to expedite your seasons.
Yes. Oh, yes.
Who was that for? Would you just lift your hand? If that's you, I mean, you want more. You want enough, so that way you don't have to go from month to month. Praise God. God says, I'm gonna bless you with enough in this time, in this season, that it's gonna last you even until your next season. Who is that for? And I'm talking about opportunities. Can I get a witness? Amen. I need the Holy Spirit. Come on, if that's you, would you just stand to your feet? I feel like prophesying to somebody. Amen. In the name of Jesus, would you just receive that? Hallelujah. That God says, I'm gonna expedite your season. Your increase is coming. There's going to be a blessing, hallelujah, with your name on it, in the name of Jesus, hallelujah. And I'm not just saying this because of logic. I'm saying this by way of the Holy Spirit. He says, with blessings, I will bless you. And with multiplies, I will multiply you. I'm going to bless your barns, your field, your car. Your increase is coming in the name of Jesus. It's a new season. Are you hearing today? Now watch, this is so true. This is so Judaic, amen, Carol. Because he says that this is not only just a day, but it's a season, a new season. It's a new season now that's going to take place. So somebody, praise God, should have gotten, watch this, and I'm so thankful, Brother Calvin, for this, that God operates according to times and seasons. Say it with me, times and seasons. So if you didn't get the blessing, praise God, that is due you.
Come on.
When the Passover or Shabbat was there, don't give up on God, because there's a new season coming your way, hallelujah. And so it's a season filled, as Tom said, it's a season filled with opportunity and blessings and challenges. And so we celebrate that just like we celebrated then. And he says, you bring your harvest. This is your harvest that is coming, amen. You bring your seed, you bring your increase, you bring your investments. Bring them all to me and watch me multiply. Can I get one witness in there?
Yes.
Now watch this. I cannot do that. But the Holy Spirit can do it all.
Yes.
He can expedite. What's Douglas said? He can expedite the healing process for you.
Amen.
And watch this. And if you are watching, and if you are a believer, oh my God, you saw more. I created I'm going to change that season. You need to be endowed with power from on high. Somebody lift up your hands and say, Lord, endow me with power from on high. I'm sorry, what did you say? I'm listening for that sound in the church. I thought there were some believers in here. I thought there were some people who knew how to praise God and worship God in spirit, process in spirit and in truth. I'm not talking to church folk. I don't need church folk right now. I need some spirit-filled believers, amen, who know how to speak and charge the atmosphere and prophesy. Young men, hallelujah, see visions. Old men, dream dreams. Handmaidens, praise God. Begin to speak, hallelujah, over your situation and watch God move. Expect the great, my God. Expect the change to take place in your life. Expect, hallelujah, the miracle, signs, and wonders. Expect a revision of the Holy Spirit as he did in Acts and Genesis chapter 1. I'm sorry, what did you say? I'm listening for the sound.